to speak for us at youth camp. And when he finished, it was getting pretty late. We need to get to the classes. And I said, let's all stand and go for our classes, not waste any more time. So, Brother Don, he reminded me of that several times. But I want to tell you one about him. He and three other gentlemen were holding a revival as young fellas at the Hatfield Church for Dad. And Brother Swampock came up to sing with them. And so Brother Don announced that they had a quartet with a fifth.
Quartet, what?
Quartet.
Don't laugh anymore, Pat.
I go. Okay, thank you.
David Matthews informed us in highly respect. The senior BMA ordained preacher.
Yeah,
he's our senior. How old are you, Don?
Oh, me? We'll just, in a couple of months, be 85. You're stealing my first point.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Brother, I'm not my hair to send around, I think, so I'm not used to doing that.
Stick it on the...
Stand right here?
No, right there on the platform. On the, Brother Jim will get it for you.
Thank you, Jim. I don't know how many times Brother Jim told that story about me in the fifth.
It's never heard.
It happened.
It happened.
Oh, Jim went this way?
Yeah.
Well, I don't know if we're going back. There we go.
Sorry to be in trouble.
You've earned that right.
It don't have to be in my face. I just don't like carrying around a microphone. I don't move around too much when I preach, so I can leave it there. Thank you, Brother Jim. I need the help on the volume, too. And if anybody can turn the temperature down a little bit, that will keep people awake a little bit better, too.
Amen.
Down or up?
Damn.
I want a cooler, whatever you have to do.
Hot dog.
You can't do anything with that.
I think David's already tried to do that. I don't know either. In my room, it says you can do whatever you want to, but we got the temperature set where it's going to be. So maybe that's the way it is here. I don't know. And that's all right. It is. I want to start out by congratulating Pastor Don Horace and Vicki for ministering and founding that church at Hillside Bethel Tabernacle and serving and just celebrated their 56th anniversary.
Amen.
I remember when they celebrated their 50th, Brother Don had asked me to come over and speak, and I don't know if he didn't know that Kevin was, Keenan Smith was going to be there or not, but Keenan Smith brought him 50 $50 bills and gave them to him right before I was going to stand up and speak. And I said, I don't know how I could compete with that. But they
$50 bills?
Yes, sir. I swear to it. Because I know it was $2,500. And I said, his church gave that to your church.
Give to the church.
Yeah, well, yeah, it's not for you personally.
Oh, okay.
Well, I don't want you to do that. I know you had $50 bills in your hand when I saw you last. No, that was 6 years ago. I don't know if you are on Facebook or read anything there very much, but I recently read Don Horace's son's attributes for his parents. Very complimentary on Facebook, and I appreciated reading that. And speaking of Keenan Smith, his church has been outstanding. In fact, I think they made the news. I think I saw a clip of that down in Houston, because they have been feeding especially first responders and many others, with over 1,000 meals a day, I believe. And I don't know if that's continuing or not, but he's had truckloads of food shipped in to him from various places. And I know that Hillside Bethel sent some food as well, and finances. We certainly have too. And I thank God for what he's doing with those who are serving the Lord faithfully. I also spoke to Brother Jose Rodriguez about Puerto Rico. That's his home, although he hasn't lived there for many years. But asking him about the situation there, and certainly they need our prayers, in, not only in Puerto Rico, but many places in the world. Right. We'll try to address that before we leave here today. And we want to invite or say happy birthday to Sandy Rodriguez. She just had a birthday, and so did Lisa. Anybody else have a birthday? Who was it?
Kevin
Horth has a birthday today?
Yeah.
All right. Send him our greetings, Brother Don.
Right.
And we just had a new arrival here in the United States, at least, from Japan. And David would like to be gone right now. His daughter just arrived at the Louisville Airport after flying back from Japan. They had a delay and had to stay overnight. And she had the baby and the dog. Oh, my. I don't like dogs that much, but some people do. And but little Finn looks like his grandpa. I've seen pictures of him, and we know what his grandpa looked like when he was that age. And if he follows his grandpa's footsteps, he'll be in good shape. By the way, he's got more than one grandfather, but I'm talking about David. Just in case you didn't understand that. I would ask you, too, to remember Brother Sambo in prayer. He has been writing to me, and I've tried to forward his message to as many as possible about his health is not well and not good. So we ask you to remember him in prayer. And certainly we remember Sister Lola Warren and her family in prayer. If you remember, Sister Nola was with us last year at this conference, and it was the first time that I think she told very many people anyway that the doctor told her that the cancer had returned, and she just went home to be with the Lord. But my, I thank God for her testimony and the work that she has done, and what God is going to do in the future because of her testimony. I thank the Lord for the opportunity to speak to you today. I've been doing more preaching than I'd like to do. In fact, the last couple of months, I've turned down at least 4 opportunities to speak. And I'm not bragging about that. I'm just saying when I stand for half hour or an hour on my feet, it takes me about a couple of days to get over it. Being 85 is not as easy as it was when I was 75. I thank God for the opportunity to speak to you today. And you pray for me as we discuss this matter of standing perfected, not just perfect, but perfected. And the scripture text that I was given is on the screen. It is about, and saying this name, I've studied a little bit, I call it Epaphras, but I understand the proper pronunciation is Epaphras. But I'm going to say Epaphras so you'll understand. I just prefer to say it that way. But it says in our text, Epaphras, who is one of you, a servant of Christ, saluteth you, always laboring fervently for you in prayers, that you may stand perfect and complete in all the will of God. For I bear him record that he hath a great zeal for you, and them that are in Laodicea, and them in Hierapolis. The modern English translation says in that phrase about his praying, that you may stand mature and complete in the entire will of God. And the Message Bible says, praying that you'll stand firm, mature, and confident in everything God wants you to do. I think they all say basically the same thing, but from a little different angle. As Brother Don has already said, my son David has been going through all the records of the past, and he called me one day and he said, "Dad, did you know that you're the oldest minister in the BMA?" And I said, "No, I didn't know that." And if that's true, I'm not sure. Brother Owens, how old is your father?
82.
82, okay. Well, he's coming, we're very close, I thought. And I thought he might be a little older than I was. But when I got to praying and thinking about that, my heart welled up when I remembered that Brother Eugene Holder's wife, Lorraine Holder, just celebrated, I think, her 96th birthday. And Brother Jack Barrow's wife, Mildred, just celebrated a birthday, and she's in her high 90s as well. And then we just visited a couple of weeks ago with Sister Margie Badger, and was thankful to be with her. She just celebrated her 96th birthday. And Sister Bonnie Masters, Pastor Mervyn Masters' wife, we just heard from her recently, and she's in her 90s as well, 93. So I'm really not the oldest as it relates to the BMA. I've got several widows who are much older. And by the way, Judy Mervyn Johnson is about a year or two older than I am, and Adeline Ashby is my age. I know that because I started at Brother A.F. Ornell's church over on 514 West Argy when I was about 6 or 7 years old, and we all were good buddies. There was no affection necessarily, but we were just sort of together. And still are. And I thank God for that and know that though I may be recognized as the oldest, and David also, by the way, told me that he was reading in the minutes when I was in high school that I made a request to become an ordained minister, and it says in the official record they denied it because I was too young. And that was about age 16, and they were right. I was too young, but got a good history behind me, a lot of stories that could be told. I spoke with our young people at youth camp just this last August, and I said something to them that certainly applies to the BMA as well. And I said to them that this youth camp will not continue unless you who are younger step up and take responsibility of leadership and carry on what we have established. Brother Jim Wilson certainly is one of those who was in the foundation of that youth camp. And we need young people who are willing to take on responsibility and do all that is necessary to be done. I have said it often, and I will say it again. Psalm 71, verse 17 and 18, has sort of become my theme and my favorite verse. It says, "O God, thou hast taught me from my youth, and hitherto have I declared thy wondrous works. Now also, when I'm old and gray-headed, O God, forsake me not, until I have showed thy strength unto this generation and thy power to everyone that is to come." Praise the Lord. Every time I read that, it thrills me to know that the writer of the Psalms and that whole 71st Psalm is about growing older and being still effective for the Lord. And I'm thankful that I can still do that as God provides the opportunity. And certainly, we as a ministerial association need the young people, young ministers, and we have several that some are not here and could be and should be. Brother Don talked to me about that earlier. Oh, if we had more of our young people here, young adults, young ministers who would take on that kind of responsibility. As I look at the world today, as you do as well, I see more division and strife and hatred and waywardness, and it burdens me. It concerns me. And as David spoke this morning about those who are taking a knee, I wrote a little blog for our family website or Facebook site about the athletes kneeling for what they felt was a cause, and how they would should challenge all of us to be on our knees praying on behalf of our nation and our leadership and those who are at the helm of our government. Certainly, we need to be praying for them.
Yes, sir.
I'll give you a couple of examples, and this is the thing that bothers me a great deal. I don't know whether this poll is correct or not, and you may not agree with the numbers. I don't want to agree with that, but in a recent poll, they asked church men about their relationship to the pornography industry, and they said in the result of their poll, and I don't know what man would admit to this, but evidently they did, 68% of the men, not in the world, but in the church, admit not only to going on the internet and watching porn, but that they are addicted to watching porn. They have to go there. It's an urgency that they somehow feel like they need. And then the thing that astounded me more than that is that this poll says that 28% of pastors say that they are addicted to porn. God, give us revival. Stir our hearts. Then I read about schools teaching kindergarten children about sex and encouraging them to wear the other sex clothing and role play what it would be like to be on the other side of that sexual gender. And I also read where some states are issuing driver's and marriage license with an X for the gender, not female or male. And that's where we are today. And as I see them destroying Civil War statues, I also read where they are erecting a monument to Baal in the park in New York City. And we are in great conflict in the world today. And there's a lot to be praying about. I read about hurricanes and earthquakes and solar eclipses and all that's going on in the world. And the old earth is reeling and rocking and rolling over in anticipation of a real coming of the Lord and a real renewing of this earth. Recently read an American Family Association magazine that had a blazing article on the top of it. It says, "Is there a reason to pray in these days?" I just mentioned a few, and you could go on and on with that. But we're considering today in our my time with you to talk to us about standing perfect, our perfecting. And maybe we should be rather talking about how to bow in prayer and really cry out to God in a way that would reach the very portals of heaven on behalf of our nation and our churches and our young people especially. I want to define the term perfect. David, yes, thank you. I've asked David to help me with that. And by the way, Brother John got the background on that. I appreciate that. I remember an old story. You probably have heard it too. Two men were talking, and the one man had married a lady whose husband had died in his youth. And the one fellow said, "Nobody's perfect." And the other fellow said, "Oh yes, there was. My wife's first husband was perfect." We joke about that a little bit in our family, because our son Dwayne passed away. It will soon be, it's 19 years now, it will soon be 20 years. Doesn't seem like it was possibly that long. I see a few of you putting sweaters on. Is it too cool now?
No.
I'm sorry if I asked for that to be too cool for you. I heard John Eggie in one of his sermons talking about a pastor who had a graveside service, and he was walking to his car afterwards, and he noticed a man a little ways down bowing in front of a tombstone. And he decided that he'd walk over there and maybe encourage him and pray for him. And just as he got within earshot, he heard the man pray, and, "Oh God, why did you take this man? Why did you let him? Why wouldn't you let him live? Because he's so perfect, and my wife thinks that." Oh God, help us as we look to the Lord to consider what is being perfect. And we begin with Matthew 5:48. I don't think I have that up there, David. That's okay. But it is a commandment. We talked about those. It is a mandate from God Himself. In Matthew 5:48, He says, "Be ye therefore perfect, even as your Father which is in heaven is perfect." Oh my, that's what He says. Is that possible? Well, I want to tell you it is, only as we stand clothed in the Lord Jesus Christ. And it's not performance, and it isn't even progress, but it is our position in the Lord Jesus Christ. As we stand in Christ, it is possible to obey Matthew 5:48 that says, "Be ye perfect even as I am perfect." God only accepts perfect offerings. In Leviticus chapter 22, verse 21, it says, "And whosoever offereth a sacrifice of peace offering unto the Lord to accomplish his vow, or a free will offering in beeves or sheep, it shall be perfect to be accepted. There shall be no blemish therein." I want you to know that God wants you perfect. He wants you without sin. There's a couple of words in the Bible that are used when we talk about perfection. And the one in Matthew 5:48 means to be without sin. And God says He can only accept us if we are without sin. And hear what Hebrews 10:14 said. All right. Very good. Thank you. You're doing good. For by one offering, that's Jesus on the cross, not anything that we would give, He hath perfected forever them that are sanctified. Amen. I hope you feel better about when you feel condemned by the things that you do wrong, that you know that your perfection is not in what you do or do not do, but it is in the Lord Jesus Christ. And He it is that has made us perfected in Christ. Hallelujah. By God's grace, I can testify that I am accepted in the Beloved and as perfect because of what Jesus Christ did for me on Calvary's cross and the way He has saved me and keeps me every day. Yeah. We think of perfect as sinless perfection. and there are those who talk about that, meaning being without sin. And that's what Matthew 5:48 really is referring to. But I'd like to suggest to you three different aspects of perfection. The one is positional perfection, and that's what we've been talking about. Paul wrote to the Philippians in 2:5, "Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus." Amen. There's where perfection lies.
Yeah.
And in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 10, it says, "Now I beseech you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you all speak the same thing." Now that gap, that need for unity. "And that there be no division among you, but ye be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgments." Wow. Oh boy, what a challenge that is. But what a possibility that is, that we can positionally be in the Lord Jesus Christ. And then there is progressive perfection. Again, in Philippians chapter 3, verse 10 through 12, Paul says, "That I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering, being made conformable unto his death, if by any means I might attain the resurrection of the dead. Not as though I had already attained, either were already perfect, but I follow after, if that I may apprehend that which also I am apprehended of Christ Jesus." What a wonderful promise and possibility we have in the Lord Jesus Christ to become progressively perfected. And then the final one is potential perfection. Again, Philippians chapter 3, verse 14 through 16 says, "I press toward the mark of the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Let us therefore, as many as be perfect, be thus minded. And if anything you be otherwise minded, God shall reveal even this unto you. Nevertheless, whereunto we have already attained, let us walk in the same rule. Let us mind the same things." Powerful scriptures that we can live by and that we can claim for ourselves. In Colossians 4:12, our text, it says that Epaphras, who is one of you, a servant of Christ, saluteth you, always laboring fervently for you in prayer, that you may stand perfect and complete in all the will of God. He's praying not only for the churches that are mentioned in our text, but for you and I as well. And the Holy Spirit is indwelling us, leading us in that direction of perfection. Real quickly, because there's so much involved in this subject, let me give you some biblical descriptions of a perfect Christian. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 17, "That the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works." It's what God promises. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 21, "Now the God of peace, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen." And then James in chapter 1, verse 4 says, "But let patience have her perfect work, that ye may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing." Powerful scriptures. James chapter 3, verse 2, "For in many things we offend all. If any man offend not in word, the same is a perfect man, and able also to bridle the whole body." Amen. I wonder if that would mean eating and exercise and proper rest and a lot of other things. But it says that we'd be able to bridle the whole body. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 10 says, "But the God of all grace, who hath called us unto his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after that ye have suffered a while, make you perfect, establish, strengthen, settle you. Amen. The next time you're suffering, being persecuted, say, Lord, perfect me. Make me more perfect in your eyes and in your sight. I would suggest to you, and as I was asked to speak on this, I read the whole fourth chapter of the book of Colossians, and I recommend it to you. Paul was certainly a giant in the early church, but he did not do it alone.
Amen.
He had a little help from his friends, as the psalm says. Paul mentions in Colossians 4 a long list of friends who worked with him. And as I thought about this and looked some other things up, I read the eulogy that a pastor read in his congregation about someone who died in his church, and he called him someone else. And he said, this church was saddened this past week to learn of the death of one of the most prominent members of the church. His name is someone else. Someone's passing created a vacancy that will be difficult to fill. Brother Else has been with us for so many years. Someone always did more than his share of work. Whenever there was a job to be done, it was someone else whose name was first on many of our to-do lists. If we had a financial need, everyone expected that someone else would step forward and make up the difference. Someone else was a wonderful person, sometimes appearing superhuman, but one person can only do so much. If the truth were known, everyone expected too much of someone else. Now he is gone, and we are wondering what we're going to do. Someone else left a wonderful example to follow. But who is going to do all of those things someone else always did? Maybe you as a pastor relate to someone else, and you may even said, I'm the someone else. And if I was gone, people would miss me. I hope so. But that you would be missed. But that you may have others to help you. Paul, in his epistles, mentions over 100 people by name that were his helpers. 26 of them are listed in the 16th chapter of the book of Romans alone. And 10 are listed here in Colossians 4. Paul lists 5 groups of friends who served with him. The faithful, the fervent, the faltering, the forgiven, the fugitive, the fellow servant, and the fickle. And if you read that fourth chapter of Colossians, you'll find their names listed. Tychius, he was a beloved, faithful fellow servant of the Apostle Paul. In fact, he founded the church at Colossae and had a lot to do with the church in Laodicea. Onesimus, you remember him in Philemon? He's mentioned by the Apostle Paul. Onesimus was a fugitive, a forgiven one, a faithful, beloved brother who served with the Apostle Paul. Aristarchus, I hope I said that right. Aristarchus, did I say that right? Whatever, risked his life with the Apostle Paul in the riot in Ephesus and sailed with Paul in that shipwreck on the way to Rome and served with Paul as a prisoner of war in the Roman prisons. And then there was Marcus, who was Mark, the forgiven, Barnabas' nephew, that Paul thought was a failure. And he's now a fellow prisoner with Paul. And then there was Jesus, whose name was in Hebrew, in Greek, Justice. And then in verse 14, we mentioned Luke, the physician, who wrote the Gospel of Mark, and Luke, excuse me, and wrote the book of Acts. Not mentioned here directly, but Demas was the one who forsook Paul, and he is also mentioned in this fourth chapter of the book of Colossians. And then there was Epaphras, that prayer warrior. And I listed five notable characteristics that are listed here in the fourth chapter of Colossians about him, just in the two verses that we read as our text to begin with. His name was common. It meant lovely, but Paul says he was one of you. So he had a name that they were familiar with. And then there was his cooperation. Paul said he's a true servant, a willing slave to his Lord and Master. And then there was his compassion. He saluted them as the founder and pastor and servant of that Colossian church. And then he was a concerned intercessor, laboring fervently for you in prayer. Spending hours, sweat, and tears, and praying for those people in his day and in that church. And then there was his constant desire that you may stand perfect and complete in all the will of God. Oh, that we might each have an Epaphras in our church. Oh, that we might become the Epaphras in our church. Because Epaphras desired the church as a whole to stand mature in the Lord, fully surrendered to God's will for their lives and for the cause of Christ. In verse 13 of our text, it says, "For I bear record that he hath great zeal for you and them that are in Laodicea and them in Hierapolis." Where are the Epaphras praying for America and the world today? Who will take his mantle? Who will stand in the gap and make up the hedge in this world today? Epaphras proved that a single life can make a tremendous difference in the lives of many for whom they pray. And the tragedy is, many spend their lifetime in a particular church and can never make an impact on anyone of their friends or fellow saints. We want to invest our lives in others. We want to help equip them to carry on. After I'm gone, what a joy it is to know that there are those carrying on afterwards. Brother Jim certainly is a prime example of a pastor who's retired and has someone in his place who's carrying on ministry that God has placed there in Hatfield, Indiana.
Yes,
I'm being invited to speak often to a congregation called Tallwood Chapel. It's not far from where I live. And Brother Don Foley, been a pastor friend of mine, probably for 20 or more years. And I have talked to him often about getting someone to take his place. On one occasion, he had a heart attack and he fell on the platform behind the pulpit, and they had to lay there until the ambulance got there and took him to the hospital. Just a few weeks ago now, I guess almost a month now, he had a carotid artery operation. Well, Jim, I thought of your wife and her situation. And he is almost unable to move. He was that way before they had that operation, but even more so afterwards. And his son, Phil, he and his wife does a lot of singing in churches, is trying to fill in for him. I think that Pastor Don Foley was trying to almost force his son to take the church. And Phil is now trying to get others to fill in. And I spoke for them several Sundays. And Phil called me and said, "Now I need somebody to speak for the next three Sundays. Can you do that?" And I said, "No. I'm sorry, I cannot. I am not physically able to do it." And I said to Phil, "You need to get together with the congregation and find a pastor for your church, because you can't fill in forever. And he doesn't want to step up and take on that responsibility." And though I love the Foley's and Tullow Chapel, and thankful for what they have, under those circumstances, they usually have about 25 to 30 people in attendance, and I don't know why and how they maintain that. But nonetheless, that's where I've been recently, and I, by the way, I'm speaking there this Sunday. Phil called me and said, "I need somebody from the 1st and the 8th and the last Sunday of October," and I said, "Well, I'm going to go to conference. I'm supposed to speak there, and I don't want to speak out before I get there. I'll take the 8th. The last Sunday is Garris's birthday, and I'm not going to take the responsibility to speak that Sunday." But the churches all over are like Tallwood Chapel, and the pastor that they have may not be all that he should be and could be if he would step up to that responsibility. Oh, there is power in prayer. Amen. That's what I would think. There is power in prayer. And I'm about close to this. It's greater than anything anyone could possibly imagine. Prayer reaches right into the very throne room of heaven.
Oh my.
I was listening, I think it was just last Sunday or Sunday before last, Charles Stanley had his 80th birthday, and his son spent a half hour talking about his dad. I know that he and his dad had had differences in times past, but evidently that's pretty well healed up. And he was talking about his dad. And he said, "I can remember as I was growing up, going to my father's study and finding him laying prostrate with his arms and legs out, praying and seeking God's will for the church and for his ministry and for the work he's done. God sees and knows and hears and answers our prayers. It's our ability to communicate directly with the Creator of the universe." And we say God can do anything, and he can. But oh, that we might enter his presence and seek his face and claim the power that he has given to us. As I was preparing this, I found this book in my wife's room where she spends a lot of her time. It's called The War Room. You probably have heard it was a very powerful movie, and this book tells that story in its completion. And the powerful thing about this story is that this elderly black lady taught a younger lady how to reach God and create a war room, a closet, where she spent hours praying and seeking God's will. And that testimony to that young lady saved her marriage. And it came time for the elderly lady to sell her home. And a minister and his wife, who were retired, was taken there by the real estate lady and explaining that this was a Christian lady. And the minister walked from room to room. And he came to what was her war room. And he said, "It's different in this room. There's something about this room. The atmosphere is charged. What happened here And the real estate lady said, well, it was her worry where she prayed for children, for a church, for so many things, and God heard and answered prayer. I don't know whether I have a war room or not.
Oh, Jesus.
But oh, how we need it
yes.
in these days. The Bible says that Esther stood before the king.
Yes.
And before she went in, she said, let us dress in sackcloth and ashes. And Mordecai, her uncle, said, God has called you for such a time as this. I wonder, is God calling you? Is God calling me to pray, to seek God's face, and to take time to pray for our nation, for its leaders, for our churches and our pastors, for those who are hurting and dying just this last weekend where they mowed down, I don't know, 60 people dead and 500 plus injured. Oh, are we concerned about that? Does that touch our hearts? Do we see the homeless sitting on the street corners begging for money? And does it affect us at all? When we hear missionaries who are on the foreign field facing insurmountable odds and the pressure of satanic powers coming against them, are we praying for them? We pray for world evangelism, for God to send laborers into the field. Oh, God, help us today to lift up one another who are here in this conference and others who are not here in our Bethel Fellowship before the Lord and spend time before Him. David started this day's session by talking about standing. And we do need to stand for the truth. But I wonder if we need to spend more time on our knees. Those football players may be giving those of us in the church a greater message than we could ever understand. Their cause, they don't even know, most of them, why they're doing it. Because they've been asked, and they don't really know. Everybody else is doing it, who is of my frame of mind. But I wonder if we don't need to begin more time of prayer on our knees before God. And I would just like to close out this session. I don't even know where I am in time. I haven't looked. It doesn't matter. Brother Jim said, I already talked to him, and he said it was okay. I want us to spend some time on our knees today. I don't know, maybe you aren't affected like I am about what's going on in our world today, but I want you to know that the Lord would perfect us on our knees when we're crying out to God. Epaphras prayed for the people in his church and in his day that they might be perfected in the will of God. Will you pray with me today? We talked about not having an altar going. Let's make an altar wherever you want to do it. But let's spend some time on our knees today before we close this day and this session. I think Brother Jim's got some of the things in mind. That's fine. But let's take just a few minutes. I don't know how long you want to pray, but I feel the need Amen. In my own heart to bow before God on my knees and pray in behalf of all those things that we've mentioned here today. God bless you.
I'm going to kneel right here in this chair. Your brothers, find a place to pray. Oh God. Hallelujah. Lord, for every pastor here, every
Jesus.